Penguin Random House Audio presents Van Gogh and the Artists He Loved by Stephen Naifeh. Afterword by Anne Dumas. Read for you by Fajer Al-Kaisi. Note to listeners. This program contains a bonus PDF with images of some works mentioned in the audiobook. Introduction. Vincent van Gogh was a revolutionary artist. He changed the nature of draftsmanship so thoroughly, he brightened the palette for serious painting so intensely, and he infused his art with so much personal character, it was hard for his contemporaries to see the merits of his work. In fact, when van Gogh died at age 37 in 1890, he was not completely unrecognized, as is sometimes thought. But it wasn't until the end of 1888, when his younger brother Theo entered three of his paintings in an avant-garde exhibition, the Salon des Indépendants, that a few major artists and writers began to give Vincent's work a serious look. And it was only 6 months before his death that a symbolist writer named Albert Ory published a widely read and overwhelmingly enthusiastic appraisal of his work in the influential French journal Le Mercure de France. Only then did several major artists see Van Gogh's paintings presented with theirs at the exhibition of Les 20, the 20, in Brussels, and recognize that a daring new artist had emerged on the art world stage. But Van Gogh never saw himself as a revolutionary artist. However original his work may have been, it was, in fact, built on a strong foundation of the art that had come before him. Van Gogh had a voracious eye for art long before he began to make it himself. At age 16, he left home to work in a prominent Dutch art gallery founded by his uncle and namesake Vincent Saint Van Gogh in The Hague. By the time Van Gogh arrived there in 1869, it had been absorbed into the most powerful international art gallery of the era, Goupil et Compagnie. There, he was able to work closely with a wide array of the day's most eagerly collected art, including work by the great French academic artists Jean-Louis-Ernest Meissonier and Jean-Léon Gérôme, and especially the brilliant new landscape painters of France and Holland, members of the Barbizon and Hague schools, respectively. In all the major cities where Van Gogh lived, The Hague, Amsterdam, Brussels, Antwerp, London, and Paris, he applied his keen eye and dervish intellect to all the art he could find. "You must, in any case, go to the museum often," Vincent instructed Theo, who followed him into Goupil et Compagnie in 1873. "It is good to love as much as one can," Vincent wrote. "One must approach all of life, but especially art and literature, with passion. For therein lies the true strength, and he who loves much does much and is capable of much, and that which is done with love is well done." Van Gogh was an inveterate proselytizer, a proselytizer for God when he trained to be a minister, a proselytizer for art when his passion shifted there. He would have been extremely gratified to know that he might one day serve to remind us of the artists he loved so passionately, especially artists who haven't maintained the universal attention and appeal commanded by his own work. One such artist was Gustave Doré. Van Gogh, who studied Doré's work intensely, would have loved a charming study by Doré of the undergrowth in a forest in Alsace-Lorraine, dark and silent, but sparkling with accents of turquoise and red, that anticipates Van Gogh's own shimmering scenes of forest undergrowth. Doré was so renowned during the late 19th century that, in 1896, more than 1.5 million people visited the Doré exhibition at the Art Institute of Chicago, a renown that has largely diminished since then. Yet Van Gogh admired Doré's work so much that he was among the artists whose black and white prints he translated into brightly colored paintings. Taste has also shifted away from the Barbizon school. A group of artists named for a village outside Paris near the Fontainebleau forest, where generations of painters found inspiration. The fin de siècle robber barons competed aggressively for their works, just as aggressively as they did for works by the Dutch and Flemish old masters. In fact, a painting by Jean-François Millet called The Gleaners sold in 1889 for the astounding sum of 300,000 francs, about $1 million today. Millet, Father Millet, as Van Gogh called him tenderly, and Camille Corot still attract the kind of audience they attracted during their own day. Other masters of the movement, however, including Jules Dupré, Narcisse Diaz de la Peña, Charles-Émile Jacques, and even Jules Breton, do not. Yet Van Gogh admired them all, believing that the Barbizon masters had not only reached the pinnacle of art, but that no one would ever eclipse them. There was still progress up to Millet and Jules Breton in my view, he wrote to Émile Bernard, an artist he had known in Paris. But as for surpassing these two men, don't talk to me of that. Van Gogh was devoted to the old masters, and their influence on his work would always be profound. But like most artists, he was especially invested in the art of his own time. For him, this was the art of the entire 19th century. The works selected for this book provide an opportunity to see the artists who were the dominant painters of that era, some of them still famous, some of them not, and to see why all of them gave the world Van Gogh inhabited so much pleasure. They provide a platform for viewing this great art, but also a prism through which to view it, the prism of Van Gogh's own appreciation. Throughout his brief career, Van Gogh declared his enthusiasm for his favorite artists in his letters, most of them to Theo, a body of correspondence so cogent in its analysis of art, so profound in its explorations on the meaning of existence, and so full of sorrow and joy that it is considered a literary masterpiece in its own right. As a result, much of the time we don't have to guess what it was about a favored artist that influenced Van Gogh. He often described it in specific detail in his wonderful prose. Crucially, when he was not describing his debt to other artists in his words, it was manifesting itself in his work. Van Gogh was so far-reaching in his tastes that it would be impossible to name every artist he admired, but we can at least identify many of the artists he admired most. And so, for example, this volume includes paintings by the French landscape artist Georges Michel, who influenced the entire Barbizon school of French landscape painting, as well as Van Gogh's own landscapes. Michel's works often feature clouds rolling across vast skies, capturing the awe before nature that was characteristic of the Romantic era. Again and again, Van Gogh used the same pictorial device to capture his own reverence for the natural world. There are several works by Jean-François Raffaelli, who shared Van Gogh's sensibility for the subject of the downtrodden. In Van Gogh's portrait of Madame Roulet, La Berceuse, woman rocking a cradle, an image so important to him that he made 5 versions of it, he focuses the viewer's attention on the working-class woman's rough hands, just as Raffaelli did in the drawing of an old peasant woman that he made for a painting that is now in a provincial town hall. A painting by Joseph Israels of a peasant family sitting around a dinner table is one of a large group of paintings by Israels that helped inspire Van Gogh's most famous early work, The Potato Eaters. The profound introspection that we find in a late self-portrait by Rembrandt, who painted himself almost 100 times, is fully evident in one by Van Gogh, who was among the few other artists to paint himself so obsessively. He made more than 30 self-portraits over a much shorter span of time. But perhaps the clearest way that Van Gogh demonstrated his admiration for certain artists was not by describing their works in extraordinary prose, or even by absorbing their qualities into his paintings and drawings, but by making his own very personal versions of their paintings. It is difficult to think of another artist of Van Gogh's greatness who continued to copy the work of other artists so late into his or her career, or to such magnificent effect. Van Gogh first learned to draw in 1880 at age 27 during his final months in the Borinage, the mining country of southern Belgium. Having utterly failed as an apprentice art dealer, he had come to the Borinage as a religious missionary, but he was completely unsuited to this new career, too. Shunned by the people he was trying to serve, and with little to occupy his time, Van Gogh spent untold hours copying the works of the old masters such as Hans Holbein, that he found in an instructional manual called the Cours de Dessin, drawing course. Assembled by two famous academic artists, Jérôme and Charles Bargue, it was the most famous and widely used such manual of its day. Theo had given it to him in the hope that it would distract his troubled brother from his lonely existence, an act of empathy that we now recognize as a pivotal moment in the history of art. But Van Gogh didn't stop copying the works of other artists when he set out to become an artist himself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.